Hey, so this is Matt Thompson. We're pretty excited to be able to talk about the DIRECTV developer APIs today. The DIRECTV API platform really lets you kind of build the future of television. We give you the full controls, let you control the set-top box, build applications that run on the TV itself, and even, you know, say completely control the TV. So if the best way to learn about the DIRECTV platform is to log on to our developer website, which Alex is bringing up right now, which is directtvdev.com. From here, you have to sign up, register through the website, but you get access to all the documentation about all the different APIs that are available. So during this webinar, we're going to talk about a couple different API sets that are available. So the DIRECTV developer platform is really separated into three different pieces. The first is what we call set-top box control. The set-top box control. And what that is that's just through simple HTTP commands. You can control the set-top box through another device within the home, which could be a mobile phone or a laptop, tablet, something else like that. Like I said, just through simple web commands. The next set of APIs that are available are HTML JavaScript applications that run on the set-top box itself. From there, you can really completely control the DIRECTV experience on the big screen. Have your app on top of the TV, control the video you're watching, or all kinds of exciting things like that. The third set of APIs are web services. And through the web services, you can remotely record a show to your DVR through the web. Or additionally, you can get access to our on-demand catalog. During this webinar and at the hackathon, we're really going to concentrate on the first two sets of APIs. Like I said, there's the set-top box control APIs and then also the HTML5 applications. So next step, Alex is going to walk you through some of the set-top box control APIs.
Yes. Hi, I'm Alex, and we're going to walk through how to control your set-top box using chef commands. So first of all, let me show you the share with you the TV app that we have. So this is going to be our TV, and let's get started. So what does a chef command look like? Well, all it is an HTTP request. You have your domain, which in this case is the IP address of the set-top box. You have your port, which is 8080. And then you have a path. The path is essentially the command. So for instance, we'd like to find out more about what we're watching right now. Well, we can issue this command. So I'm going to send it. And I get back a JSON. It has a lot of data fields here. The important ones are the call sign, which is the channel name. Then there's the major, which is the channel number. Then there's the duration, the amount of, which is in seconds, the duration of the program. And another important one is the offset parameter. The offset parameter tells you how far into the program you are. So for instance, if you note, it's 7,465 seconds right now. If we refresh, see that it has changed. So you can use this to sync your playback across multiple systems, for instance. So this is one chef command that gives you some information about what you're watching right now. But let's say you want to control the box, make it do something. Well, you can also do this through a different set of commands. In this case, it's TV2. And it works according to the same principle. You have your set-top box ID, the port number, then the path, then you pass in a parameter, the major parameter, with a value, in this case, it's 351 for C-SPAN 2. So let's take a look at the TV right here. We have our TV. It's tuned to C-SPAN 1, I believe. And so let's issue this command and see it change to C-SPAN 2. This is the principle according to which all the chef commands work. Let's go next to a sample application that we built for you and see how you can overlay your app on top of the screen and interact with the set-top box. So the next thing we need to do is to launch this app? Well, we're going to sidetrack here for a second and introduce to you a tool called Postman. The Postman tool is, you might find it very useful because it's an alternative to what we've been doing in the browser. So here we had two tabs for the two commands that we've been using. You might end up using 10 or 20 commands. The Postman app tool is a HTTP request tool that helps you issue these commands very quickly with just one click of a button. How do we do that? Well, we navigate to the collections here, and right here you see that we have predefined for you a collection, a DIRECTV Chef commands collection. Where do we get this collection? Well, if we navigate back to the hackathon guide right here and search for Postman, we can see that under step number 4, the workflow, under point number 2, there's a link to the Postman collection. You download this collection, then you import it into Postman using this import button right here, and then you have access to all these commands. Now, you can see that these commands mirror the documentation that we have on the directtvdev.com site. I highly recommend going through this documentation when you are at the actual hackathon and learn which commands are available to you and which aren't. So anyway, let's try to do the same thing we did before. Let's use Postman to tune to something or to get some information first. Now, this is the command as you've seen before. However, here we have, instead of the set-top box IP, we have a variable. And this is how Postman works. We predefine this variable once in this menu, manage environments, in this area right here. And then once we define it once, we can use it across all the commands that are available to us. So anything here that you click, for instance, STD IP will stay the same. But let's send this right now and take a look. Here you can see that we get the same results we got before, only in this format right here. Let's tune to something. So let me bring up the RTD app, Postman, change channel to back to C-SPAN, 350, send, and it changes. So this is how Postman works. Now we wanted to launch an app. Well, the way to do that is to go to the ITV folder, get the start URL command, and right here you have a URL variable which we can just replace and hard code to the URL that we need. If you've been issuing these commands before, you have a history of the stuff that you have issued before. So if we navigate to history right here, I have done this before, so I'm just going to find the command that I need, which is this one right here, and you can see that it's the set-top box ID, port, ITV start URL. The URL parameter is set to the URL that my app lives on. In this case, it's on my localhost. So we're going to hit send, and the app is going to appear on the TV. So what does this app do? Well, let's see. I'm at the moment, you can't see it, but I'm pressing buttons on the remote, and you see numbers appear on the screen. Well, all it does is that it grabs the remote key that I press and outputs the key code that's associated with it. So in this case, I press 1, 49 is associated with that, 2, 50, so on. It's a pretty simple app, so let's take a look at how we built this. I'm going to share with you my text editor. Okay. So there are three things you need to pay attention here. First thing is the navigator.setResolution call. You want to do that as early as you can in your code to tell the box to set itself to 1920 by 1080. This is the best resolution the set-top box can support, so it's in your best interest to set it to these numbers. The second thing you want to do is register the onKeyDown event on the window object right here. Your key handler, in this case, this function, is a pretty much a very large switch state, very long switch state. What happens here is that we get the event, we get the key code from this event, and then based on that value, we'll look at the keys and execute whatever we need to do. Now, obviously, you're not going to use all these cases that we have listed for you here, but this is a great starting point for you to just copy into your own app and use the keys that you need. And all of these are documented on the directvdev.com site and also here. Now, very important thing to note is that if you don't want your keys to bubble up to your UI, you should return false at the end of your key handler right here. What do I mean by that? Well, let's see. If there's nothing right here, my app's not running, and then I hit up, then we get this quick to menu. Now, if my app were running and I'd hit up and not return false at the end of the key handler, then this would show up overlaying my app. This is not the user experience you want to have, so make sure to return false at the end of your key handler for this not to happen. The third thing about this app is the onError event. Now, the reason why it's important to return true at the end of this handler is because if you don't, then and your app throws an error, then your app will exit, maybe without even showing up on the screen. So you might be wondering, hey, why is nothing showing up? I keep starting my app and I don't see anything. Well, it might be because there's a 404 error, for instance, and you're missing an image or a file. And if you're not returning true, your app will exit and you will not see it appear. Very important to return true at the end of this event handler. Now, let's take a look at the hackathon guide page. Now, we've seen that our Postman collection link is on this page, but let's take a look what else is on it. We have, I believe, six steps that guide you through setting up the box, launching your app, the workflow, which Postman is a part of, the debugging process, the tips that you will definitely want to read before you start developing, because a lot of times people develop and spend a lot of time getting this just one thing right on in their browser, and then it turns out that it's not supported by the box. So make sure to read through these tips beforehand. Now, step five is very important, the debugging process. You know, you develop your app and it looks great in the browser, and then you launch it and something goes wrong. And you want to see the console logs that you've been printing out. So where do you see it? Well, it's also, you can also use a chef command, which is the etcd get logs command. Let's issue this command again. Okay, so this is a very, very long output that you get, and a lot of these logs do not pertain to you. They're setup box logs. You don't want to read into them. What you do want to look at is the WebKit logs. So search for WebKit. In this case, I'm using command F to search, and here we go. I'm looking at the WebKit logs that have been printed out. So let's look here. We have load progress 10. This tells us that the app is launching. We have load progress 50 and 100. 100 means the load is complete. Also, I don't know if, yes, I think you can see. Also in this, you can look at the yellow stripes to the right and see where all the logs are. The most recent logs will appear at the end, at the bottom of the screen, bottom of the page. So right here, most recent logs appear. And we see that the most recent app has been indeed launched. And so on. So this is how you debug on the setup box. Now, the next app that we'd like to show you is the cycle through app. Now, the reason why I would like to show you this app is because this app actually controls video playback on the set-top box. And what do we mean by that? Well, let's navigate to Postman, to my history, and launch it on our TV. Now let's see what this app does. We can go right, go left, and hit select. So let's hit select on Rich Eisen Show. And we've switched to the Rich Eisen Show. Now we're watching this. Now we're done watching this, we're going to C-SPAN 2. You can hit that, and now the box is playing channel C-SPAN 2. This is a showcase of how to control the playback, the video playback of the box. Internally, this app is not much different from what we've seen before, but there are a couple of things that are important to note. So let's take a look. The first thing that I want to talk about is the playing content from the DVR. First of all, the command is the path is DVR/play. There are two parameters that you pass in. First, in the unique ID parameter, which is in this case set to 318. Now, how do you find this value? Well, you use another DVR command. In this case, you use the playlist command. So, DVR playlist action get. Let's issue that command. And what this returns is all the items that are recorded on your setup box. In this case, we only have one item, and but that's all we need because here's the unique ID that we're looking for, 318. So this is where it comes from. Now, you don't need to go to the browser to, get this JSON. You might do it from your code programmatically as we are doing it here. And to do that, you can choose any means you like to issue an HTTP request. In this case, we're using the jQuery's AJAX library. So we got the 318. Now, how do you make the app persist across different video playbacks on the box? Well, if you don't pass this parameter from app equals true, then what would have happened is that I would have clicked once on Rich Eisen Show, and then once that came up, my app would have exited. If we don't want the app to exit, you need to pass in from app equals true. Now, this being said, it will not work the same way if you want to tune to a different channel. So from app equals true, even if you pass it into the tune command, it will not work. So in order to have that working, you need to use the channel object that we provide for you. And this is the code we see here. We're using channel object, get channel by viewer channel, method, pass in the channel number, and then do channel.tune. Now, all the objects that are available to you are also documented on our site under HTML5 apps, JavaScript extensions for TV, and here they are. Take a look at those if you'll be using them at the hackathon. And this is the, in essence, the app that controls the playback. Now, Matt, we've also written multiple apps, multiple sample apps for you, which you can find on the hackathon page. And they are listed right here. The first one is the sample app. We've talked about that. There's an MP4 app. There's an HLS app. There's a WebSocket app. There's also these two apps right here. Now, WebSockets are pretty cool, and we do have support for them on our setup box. So Matt is going to talk to us about the WebSocket app.
So while Alex is launching the WebSocket app, I'll talk a little about what you can use that for. Again, one of the apps that we often see at hackathons, and in general, I think one of the kind of drives of bringing DIRECTV and AT&T together is really tying together mobile devices and the TV experience. Now, you're going to need a way to kind of seamlessly synchronize those different devices, and WebSockets is a really easy way to do that. Again, with WebSockets, it gives you synchronous communication across multiple devices, and this is the example that we've provided for you. So while Alex is getting this set up, what you're seeing here is there's a big DIRECTV logo on the TV, and there's a There's a DIRECTV logo on the TV, and there's a DIRECTV logo on the browser. And what's going to happen here is, as I click over to the web browser and I press the right arrow, you'll notice that as it moves across the web browser, it moves across the TV as well. I can go up, down, left, right, and the two items are synchronized. Now, if I were running that exact same URL on the Google Chrome in my iPhone or Android device, I could use touch controls, kind of move it around in real time, you'd see the image synchronize across the two different screens. Now, if I were to add multiple set-top boxes, multiple phones, all of that would seamlessly synchronize together as you move one or the other. And of course, I'm just using CSS to update the location of an object on the screen, but you could use the same communication method, let's say, to synchronize which show they're currently watching, how far they are into the program, chat, all different kinds of applications like that. So let's take a look at the code. Let me switch over to the text editor here. Now, there are two parts to this. There's a server component and a client component. In this case, for the server component, we're just using Node.js, and that's what I'm going to show you first. So within Node.js, we're using a couple modules. One is Express. Express is a real easy way to set up a web browser, sorry, web server within Node. We're also using Socket.io. Socket.io is a great library to simplify the setup of WebSocket communication. And then one other library here I'll show is Hammer.js. What Hammer.js allows you to do is use touch events within the browser on your phone or tablet. So that's kind of the setup, but what are we really doing with WebSocket? It's actually pretty simple. It's just this snippet of code here. We first set up our server. The next step, we turn on the connection. And then the way that WebSockets work within Socket.io is really just a key value pair. In this case, our key is called head move. And whenever we see this head move event, there's an object that gets associated with that that's broadcast across the WebSocket. So head move, we get a function with the data, and whatever data we get in this head move, we just turn around and broadcast it with the using the key head position and just send out the data. So this is the server side. It's basically listening for the head move event. Whatever data it gets, the data in this case is just the location of this graphic on screen, it just turns around and broadcasts it to all the clients. So let's jump over to the JavaScript side, what's actually running on the client. So the code that I'm showing here, let me go up to the top. This code and this web app, right, is actually the exact same app as running on the set-top box. That's running on the browser as well. So a minute ago, I showed you how we were broadcasting this head position key within WebSocket using Socket.io. Right here, what I just highlighted, this is where the client actually listens for that communication and then updates the CSS. So we listen for head position. When we get that, we use the data that comes in to set the CSS of big head, which is in this case, this graphic, basically to set the CSS or whatever's broadcast through that message. That's all there is to it. Now, let's say if you're on the set-top box using the remote control to move around that logo on screen, that'll stay synchronized too. Let's scroll down a little bit more past all of the touch events. And what you see here is another big switch event with key codes, just like Alex showed previously. In this case, we're updating, if you press the left key, right, we'll update the big head position to new coordinates. And at the bottom of this big switch statement, there's this update big head function. Now, what that function does right here is, kind of just like we showed before, it takes whatever the current CSS position of that logo and then broadcasts it across. That's all there is to it. Right here, we see we get style.left, set it in this. And then at the bottom of here, this is your simple Socket.io command where you say emit head move with the new position. Once you do that, it goes up to the server sets up the clients, and everything stays synchronized. Again, we're just using it for CSS, but you could send any message you wanted to using the same setup. And Socket.io is a great way to do it, real fast way to get you started. So those are all the kind of examples that we have right now. Like Alex has been saying a couple times, check out the developer website. Go through the hackathon guide. We have lots of other code, examples, documentation, hopefully everything you need to really get started building apps with DIRECTV. We want to make sure you have all the tips and tricks and tools that you need. And, you know, we're really excited to see what developers come up with at the hackathon. And we can hopefully support you and give you everything you need to really build the future of television with DIRECTV. So at this point, I think we're concluded with our side of the webinar, but I think we're going to work and see if Laura can help us answer any questions you might have.
Yeah, now would be a great time for any questions that need to come in. One came in during your presentation, and it said that the drop-down menu for the HTML5 app development documentation is not available on the website. Do you know where they could get the HTML5 app development documentation then?
Yeah, so what you'll need to do is actually register. Once you register with the website, then you'll have access to all the different sections.
Great. Okay, and then another question just came in. So it says, who can approve my developer account?
Who can approve your developer? So if you sign in, create an account and sign in, you should automatically have access to everything within the website. So if you have if anybody has any problems with that, you can send us an email at questions@directtvdev.com, and we can help you out with any registration. But basically, if you just register, click through the terms of service, T's and C's, and after that, you'll have access to the developer website.
Okay. We have a follow-up question to the HTML5 one, and it says that he has registered, but he doesn't have access to the HTML5 app docs.
Okay. We'll follow up on that because you should have access to it. We'll make sure you have access.
Okay.
We also get a record of everyone who signs up, so we can make sure that we can turn that on if you don't have that.
Great. Right now we don't have any more questions just yet. If anybody wants to send out their questions, otherwise I can wrap up the session. Okay. Well, it doesn't look like we have any other questions coming in right now. So I just want to say thank you to Alex and Matt for this look into building the future of video with DIRECTV. This presentation and all of our other Bootstrap Week presentations will be made available next week on our YouTube channel at youtube.com/attdev and our AT&T Developer Portal blog at developer.att.com. Thank you, everyone, for participating in this Bootstrap Week event. If this interested you, please see our other Bootstrap presentations this week at attdeveloper.webex.com. Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you guys for joining.
Thank you.
Okay, bye.